Hello students, so this is our second session on refraction. In the first session, we discussed the optics of the refractive errors. We learned how to decode or how to understand glass prescriptions. Now in this session, we will be discussing the clinical aspects of the different kinds of refractive errors, and we will be discussing the treatment of refractive errors. So see, in the previous session, we had looked at the eye only as an optical system. And we were trying to analyze what are the optics of the different kinds of refractive errors, where the light is focusing, whether it is in front of the retina, whether it's on the retina, whether the refraction is the same in the two meridians. So all this optical part of it we discussed. And for a while, we almost forgot that the eye is actually a biological structure. It's a part of the body. So now we will be looking at the clinical aspect of it. We will see what are the clinical manifestations in myopia, in hypermetropia, and what are the ocular changes that happen in each of these refractive errors. So just to quickly revise, what are the different types of refractive errors? The three types of refractive errors are myopia, hypermetropia, and astigmatism. So the three types of refractive errors that we have, they are myopia, hypermetropia, and astigmatism. So let me start with the clinical features of myopia. So let us look at this. So what did we learn about myopia? That is the parallel rays of light, that is the rays of light which are coming from a distant object. After refraction, they are brought to focus at this point F, which is in front of the retina, right? So these parallel rays, that is these are the distant rays, and they are brought to focus at this point, which is in front of the retina. So that means that the distant rays in a myopia, which is uncorrected, in an uncorrected myopic patient, the distant rays will not focus on the retina. They are not meeting on the retina. They are meeting in front of the retina. So therefore, in myopia, the distance vision is affected. The distance vision in these patients, it will not be good, right? Now, what about the near rays? Let us look at this picture and try to fathom what will happen to rays of light which are originating from a near object here. Now, rays of light which are originating from a near object, these are the distant rays. What we have drawn, these are the distant rays. Now, the near rays, what happens is these near rays, they easily focus on the retina. So, these near rays, they focus at this point F dash, which is on the retina. So, see, the distant rays are problematic because they are focusing in front of the retina. The distance vision in these patients is not clear. But for rays which are originating from a near object, these near rays, they end up focusing on the retina. So, this point F dash, this is on the retina, and this is where the near rays are focusing. So, therefore, see, the near vision is actually normal in these patients. So what is the problem in a patient with myopia? The optics of it says that the distant rays are focusing in front of the retina. The near rays are easily focusing on the retina. Now, if I convert this to a clinical presentation, the distance vision is obviously affected or it is difficult, whereas the near vision is normal. So that is why the other name for myopia is short-sightedness. It's also called as short-sightedness, meaning the near vision is good, but the distance vision is not. The near vision is good, but the distance vision is affected. So the near vision is normal and the distance vision is affected. So we call it as short-sightedness. Some people also call it as near-sightedness. Okay, now let us see what are the causes of myopia. The commonest type of myopia is axial myopia. There is an increased axial length or increased length of the eyeball. Now see, when children are born, they are born with small eyeballs. Gradually, the size of the eyeball increases. Now, if it increases beyond a certain point, then that will give rise to axial myopia. So this is the commonest type of myopia. The presentation of these is children who are like 7 to 8 years old, that is children belonging to second or third standard, who are brought to us with complaint that the child is not able to see the blackboard clearly if he sits in the back benches, or he's not copying down his notes properly in the class. Obviously, the child is not able to see. Or they say that he watches the television by going very close to the television. He holds his books very close while reading. So all this is suggestive of the fact that the distance vision of this kid is not good. So that most of them are axial myopes. A small percentage of patients they have what is called as curvatural myopia, which is because of an increased curvature of the cornea, right? So because the corneal curvature increases, that also gives rise to a myopic shift in diffraction. And the third is called as index myopia. Now, index myopia, this is seen in elderly patients. And why do you get it this in elderly patients? In elderly patients, because of the development of nuclear cataract, there is a change in refractive index of the eye. So there is a change in the refractive index in elderly patients, and this gives rise to a myopic shift in refraction, and that's called as index myopia. So this will be an old patient, like 60, 65 year old, suddenly seeing that the glass power has changed from -1 to say -3, and this is called as index myopia. So the commonest is axial myopia, which we see in children, curvatural a small percentage, and index, which we see in elderly. Now this axial myopia that we see, which I told you is the commonest variety, this can either be a simple myopia, that is it can be either simple, where there is an increase in the length of the eyeball, or it can be something which is called as pathological myopia. Now, what exactly we mean by pathological myopia is, in pathological myopia also, there is an increase in axial length, but there is a disproportionate increase of the posterior segment. So, in simple myopia, both anterior and posterior segment are expanding, but expanding proportionately. But in pathological myopia, there is a disproportionate increase or disproportionate expansion of the posterior segment of the eyeball. So the posterior segment stretches very much. The anterior segment doesn't stretch that much. And in the posterior segment, what is the structure we have? We have the retina. So the retina gets unduly damaged, and therefore pathological myopia, in later stages, it is one of the important causes of vision loss. So in pathological myopia is also axial, but there is a disproportionate increase in length, or there is a disproportionate enlargement of the posterior segment. There is overstretching of the retina, and this can give rise to poor vision later in life, right? So these are the different causes of myopia.